Myself Nagma. Today 10th standard will deal with the poem The Sorrow Screen, up to a pair of sorrow screen, written by Manmohan Singh. This is a poem which speaks about a deep bond of two birds, sorrow screen, a couple. Sorrow screen. When one sorrow screen was killed by killers, and it was taken away by the killers. At that time, the poem speaks about the sorrow she faced, the sorrow she shows, the agony she faced, and ultimately she gives her life after that. And she thinks that if the male crane is not allowed, it is useless. If I cannot give life to the male crane, it is useless to live a life without his mate. So we'll read the poem first, then in short I will say the summary of the poem. The male was shot as he necked to pull the reluctant sun out from the rim of horizon. She flew crying as he was picked up, hands and jaws, and a proud neck was humbled to lie like dirty linen in a coarse washing bag. She circled the sky in a moment of a glaze over his disgraceful end. The killers went away as she returned to the death scene with grief that inscribed its intensity in dots and pips, like the Morse code of birds' sorrow transmitted to air. With her beak, she kissed few feathers, picked the ones that winds had not taken away, and sat to hatch the blood-stained feathers into a toddling chick. A wave of the sea she had never seen came to her from far away and carried her to him. She went away beyond Hume's legends and fables of human love. So there was a pair of sorrows, and this incident happened in the morning, in the morning session, that is in the when it was just sun was rising. And when the sun was rising, the first line of the poem itself says the male was shot. The male was shot as he necked to pull the reluctant sun out from the rim of horizon. The poet tries to say that the sun was not ready to come out from the horizon of the hills as the male bird was killed. Why the sun was not ready to come out? It is because the male bird was killed. She flew crying as he was picked up, hands and jaws, and a proud neck was humbled to lie like a dirty linen in a coarse walking bag. So after killing the sorrow screen, the male bird, the killers picked it up from the jaws, hands and jaws, that is its wings and jaws. This neck was hanging, hands and jaws, and a proud neck was humbled. A proud neck. The sorrow screen's neck was almost always high. It is a sign of proudness to it. And the proud neck was humbled. Humbled means it is almost humbling means when you bow down, you humble you. You bow down, it is same way you are humble. your every proudness is gone there. It was humbled. To lie like a dirty linen. Dirty linen means like a dirty cloth. It was thrown away. It was lying like on the ground like a dirty linen. And the killers collected the body like a dirty linen and they put it in a washing bag. She circled the sky in moments of grace over his disgraceful end. So while they were taking the male crane, the female crane, she was circling on the sky, in the sky, while she was watching over there. The killers went away and she returned to the death scene. So she was screaming and circling over the in the sky, and when they went away, the female bird came to return to the death scene where the body was lying. She came to that place with the grief that inscribed its intensity in dots and pits. In dots and pits, she was so grieved. She is in such a sorrow that you can't explain. It is in so intensity, so deep. In dots and pits, like a Morse code of word sorrow transmitted to the air. She was screaming in such a sorrow, such an intensive sorrow and its intensive scream. The scream was like it shown here, like a Morse code, dots and pits of a Morse code, so that she can get the call back from the male bird. Just her intention is to get a return call, a voice from her mate. With her beak, she kissed a few feathers, picked the ones that wind had not taken away. She sat to hatch the blood-stained feathers into a toddling chick. So she sat on the place where the body was lying of the male bird, and she tried to pick the feathers which were not flew away from the wind, and she tried to kiss the blood stain so that she can give life to her male counterpart. Away off the sea, she had never seen. See, in this para they have said she is trying to give life to her male counterpart and mate, her mate. And she, when she could not give life, she understood that her male has gone far away from her, and it is her time. A wave of the sea she had never seen came to her from far away. A wave of seas. This wave of sea is metaphorically explained here. Metaphorically has brought out to say the death. A wave of sea. Yeah, it is compared to death here. Came to her from far away. She carried to him and carried to her. She went away beyond Hume's words, beyond the legends and fables of human love. Now, the wave of sea, it is the wave of sea is nothing but death, and it carried her to him. So she also died. She went beyond Hume's word. Hume's word. Who is Hume here? Hume is a author who has written The Game Birds of India, Burma and Ceylon. So he is mainly a writer who has spoken, he has referred about this beautiful couple, about their love and their pairing. He has written about that. In fact, Soros Crane are famous for their love with each other, and their pairing is very strong. If one couple or one bird dies, the other two will die after that. So their connection, their relationship is very strong. She went beyond Hume's words, beyond the legends, fables of human love. You can't find this type of connection, this type of relation, a deep intense relations in human being. They have gone beyond this male train and female train. They have gone beyond. Their love has gone beyond the Hume's word and human love. So I will tell it in really deeply. I will explain this. The male bird was flying high in the sky at dawn when the sun was rising. When he was shot, as he stretched his neck to pull out the sun, which was hiding behind the edges of the skyline. So sun has not arrived yet. It was just arriving. The female bird, seeing her mate shot down, was crying in despair. When the female bird saw that her male bird had been shot by the killers, it started crying in despair. It started screaming in sadness. As she saw him being picked up with the legs and jaws, by the hunters, she saw that her male mate has been taken, picked up by the jaws and her hands, that is wings, by the hunters. His proud and beautiful head was humiliated to be thrown in like dirty clothes into a rough washing bag. So the body of the saurus crane, male saurus crane, was thrown into the bag, a dirty bag, which was it is nothing but a humiliation to such a beautiful bird. Such a beautiful bird is humiliated in that way. How the hunters picked it up from its jaws and wings, and how they throw the body of the male crane into a dirty bag, is nothing but a humiliation and insult to the body of a saurus crane. She started circling the sky, moving gracefully, witnessing his tragic end. The hunters took him away and she returned to the scene of death. With pain and grief to cow and stretch for him in the ditches and scream to convey her sorrow into the air like Morse code. So when they took the body of male crane with them, with the hunters, she started screaming in the sky to convey her sadness to the male bird. In the ditches, in the forest areas, in the skies, she started screaming to convey, to tell, to inform how sad she is about the death of her male bird. She searched, found and kissed his few feathers that were not blown away by the wind, and sat to hatch those blood-stained feathers back to life. So she found some feathers lying on the place where the body fell from the sky when the hunters shoot the bird from distance. She found the feathers and some blood stains were there. She went to that place and collected the few feathers lying on the ground, and she tried to kiss the blood stains on the ground. She tried to give life to the blood stains. At least if I kiss these blood stains, maybe my male bird, my saurus, the male saurus crane, may come to life. A wave of sorrow came over, as if the wave came from heaven. She too joined him far into the world of death, beyond the words of Hume's legends and fables of human love. So at the end, she too dies in grief, in sadness. Her agony, her despair was so deep, it was so intense, she could not control her feelings. She could not resist the shock she got from the death of this male crane, and she too died after they have taken the body of male crane. So they have given Hume's words. Hume is a writer who wrote about these words, that they mate for life dying in grief after the death of their mate is the killed calling constantly. So after, if one male or female crane dies, the other crane would call the dead bird constantly, and it too will die. So this is special about these birds. So in the last stanza, the poet talks metaphorically about the sea being the metaphor for death, and the wave of the seas is the call of the death, which the female bird had never seen before. So death no one sees. Even the female bird had not seen the death. Her sadness, her agony, she had never seen this in her life, and due to this shock she died. This shock was first time for her in her life. So never before in her life. Sorrow's cranes do not live near the seashore. In turn, the author actually is talking about the shock and despair the female bird experienced at the loss of her mate, and hence joined with him in the death. So actually they have said the wave of the sea had come and taken the female bird. So basically sorrow's crane never live beside their habitation is not in seaside. They live in hillsides. So this is just a comparison shown to say that wave of sea is the sorrow. Wave of sorrow came over her, and because of this wave of sorrow, she died along with the male. So it's a beautiful poem written by Manmohan Singh, and this is about love and relationship of two cranes, sorrow's cranes, which a human cannot understand, nor can a human bond is never. A human bond is so strong as this sorrow's crane. So I hope you have understood this poem. Try to read this poem deeply, understanding each and every word. Some of the words, difficult words, have been given in the end of the poem, that is in the glossary, and especially Hume and Morse code. These are very important, and the sun hesitant to rise, this is also very important, and the wave of seas, which is compared to death, this word is also very important. How she collected the feathers and how she kissed the blood stains, these all are very important in this poem. Basically these words usually come in exam regularly. So I hope you have understood the poem.